Broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good morning, everyone. We are from Nexdigm. We will go live in a few minutes. We're just waiting for a few more participants to join in. So we would be going. We would be starting the presentation in about 2-3 minutes from now. Thank you very much for your patience, and looking forward to having you with us. Hi, Neil. We are live.
Hi, Jugal. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us on this rainy Dallas morning. We are delighted to have our partners, the SKP Group and Nexdigm, presenting this webinar on the analysis of the union budget for 2020. Nexdigm is one of our members, primarily based out of India, but they do have offices in Chicago and another global office in Toronto. They are a global multidisciplinary group delivering an array of quality-driven solutions covering business consulting, business services, and professional services. They have operations currently in the USA, as I mentioned, in Chicago, the UAE, India, and business desks in Canada, Hong Kong, Japan, and other places around the world. Nexdigm provides integrated solutions to primarily Fortune 500 companies, other multinational companies, as well as privately held companies and family-owned businesses from over 50 countries. 80% of their clientele are international. And Nexdigm truly understands the needs of these foreign companies and is able to assist them in a variety of tax, accounting, and other advisory services. SKP has been around for several years, and Nexdigm is their North American kind of entity. They help U.S. businesses with their local operations, global expansion plans, and India entry strategy. Their services include market research and greenfield support for entry into India, corporate services for Indian subsidiaries, supply chain optimization, and end-to-end project management for a variety of initiatives. So today, to cover the union budget, we have two very distinguished professionals from Nexdigm. We have Shivendra Dvivedi. He's a senior manager in the indirect taxation practice. Shivendra has more than 9 years of experience handling advisory and compliance assignments under service tax, customs, GST, and foreign trade policy. And his experience includes handling litigation under customs, and transaction structuring under GST. This is extremely helpful for companies that have goods and services flowing around India and then also in and out of India. And he has served companies in consumer electronics, chemicals, FMCG, defense, finance, and the entertainment sectors. So he has a breadth of experience. I'm sure he's gonna help to help us understand this union budget well. Also joining us is Nishit Parikh. Nishit has a master's in commerce from Mumbai University. He has advised clients in the areas of domestic and international, he has assisted domestic and international clients on matters relating to international tax, FEMA, and structuring of inbound and outbound investments. He has extensive experience in the areas of income tax and international tax, the international tax treaty provisions, and also FEMA. Nishit has also authored numerous articles on topics such as indirect transfers of shares, business connections, BEPS, service PE, and other topics, which have been published in major industry journals, such as the International Taxation Journal, taxman.com, and others. So I'm gonna hand it over to our team from Nexdigm and SKP to take this webinar forward. And on behalf of the US India Chamber of Commerce, we hope you find value in this presentation. And if you would like to provide us with feedback after the presentation is done, please send us an email to info@usicoc.org. Thank you so much, and SKP and Nexdigm team, it's all yours.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Neil. Pleasure to have this webinar for your members. I'm handing over the mic to Nishit to begin with the direct tax proposals. Over to you, Nishit.
Good morning, everyone. So I will be taking you through certain key announcements which were made in Indian budget and through some of the direct tax proposals which were mainly impacting US companies who are either doing business in India or planning to do business with India, and also some bit of personal tax which would impact the expats who are mainly looking to come to India from US. So starting with the Indian budget started or was based on three main themes. One was aspirational India, whereby government has focused on providing health to everyone, education to everyone, and employment to everyone. Second biggest agenda of the budget was economic development, to have reforms across economy to ensure that economy is up and running, and also focus on private sector investment. And third was on more on the caring society, on the human and the empathetic side, whereby they clearly mentioned that the taxpayers and the wealth creators of the country would be respected and given the due respect, and there would not be any undue harassment by the tax authorities. So this was the three main cornerstones of the budget, through which the entire budget was announced, and keeping in mind all these three important aspects. So on the economy front, India has now become the fifth largest economy of the world, and it is already third largest in terms of purchasing power parity. India is, the government actually mentioned that India is looking at a 10% nominal growth rate for the next year. On the fiscal deficit side, India has maintained a 3.8% fiscal deficit target for financial year 1920 and 3.5% for 2021. And total government spending is going to be INR 30.4 trillion. On the infrastructure side and on the agriculture side, the government was very clear that they will continue with the work which they are doing on development of the highways and electrification of the railway tracks. And also on the agriculture side, a lot of incentives are being given to the Indian farmers to ensure that the growth is appropriate, and also they are incentivized to carry out more exports out of India. On the education side, the government's focus is to introduce a new education policy and make India one of the hubs where actually students come in from across the globe to carry out higher education. And in order to promote this new education, they would provide appropriate funding to the sector by way of allowing or liberalizing the norms for foreign currency borrowing in the sector, and also liberalizing the norms for equity investment into the sector. For MSME, again, various schemes were introduced. One of them was NIRVIK, which was providing higher insurance cover to small exporters, handholding and providing support for the new technology upgradation and R&D. And on the financial service sector side, a lot of steps were taken, the important ones being FPI limits in investment on corporate bonds of India increased to 15% from 9%, and the Life Insurance Corporation, which is a huge government-owned corporation in India, to be made public via the IPO route and get listed on the stock exchange, so that government will get a huge amount on the disinvestment of LIC overall. So now moving to, before actually getting into budget, India had a very big reform done in September 2019. So we would just, before getting into the budget changes, for benefit of everyone, take you through what were the important changes which happened in September 2019. India made massive corporate tax rate cuts in line with what was expected out of the government to address the slowdown in the economy. So, and also with the trade war between US and China, which was going on, to invite more and more companies to set up manufacturing base in India, Indian government has introduced new provisions whereby it is provided that any company which sets up in India between October 2019 to 31st March 2023 to carry out manufacturing activities would be provided a beneficial corporate tax rate of 15%. So it is one of the lowest tax rates in the world now for manufacturing companies. So if a manufacturing company is set up in India between this specified period, only 15% tax has to be paid by them. And this 15% has to be added by education cess and surcharge. So effectively, the tax rate goes to around 17%. But that 17% tax is a very good tax rate, mainly when India actually had a tax rate of around 35%. So moving straight away from 35% of tax, corporate tax to 17% is a big move. Second big amendment was for companies which are existing companies, including manufacturing as well as other companies, the corporate tax rate was reduced from 35% to effective rate of 25%. So it is reduced to 22%, and if you add up education cess and surcharge, it works out to 25.17%. So straight away a corporate tax rate cut of 10% for existing companies, and for new manufacturing units setting up 17%. So this was a very big corporate reform which was made by the government in 2019. So now India has become an attractive destination for investment, and not only the tax rate, there are many other factors which actually make India a very good market. One is the large population, which India has, second highest population in the world. So there is a big consumer market in India, availability of highly talented talented resource in India, and India being one of the youngest population in the world, provides a lot of talent. Plus there are specific state incentives which are provided by the state governments in India for encouraging the companies to set up in respective states. Then India-US has excellent bilateral strategic relations. So tax treaty is in place, investment protection treaty is in place. So all those makes India a very good market, one for manufacturing as well as for ultimately selling in India, and mainly for US corporation, because US also has reduced the corporate tax rate. So overall, India could become a good country for setting up as a manufacturing base. So if I have to just give an example as to what has changed for India. So if you look at the old regime, there was a tax which was around 34.95%. Under the new regime for existing company, it is 25.17%, and for manufacturing company, it is only 17.16%. So earlier, what was happening, that if a dividend was distributed and ultimately US shareholder used to get only $55 if there was a profit of $100. But under the new regime, and if it's a manufacturing company, US shareholder would get around $70 if the profit is around $100. So this becomes an excellent opportunity for companies to set up in India. So now moving on to the proposals in the budget 2020. Since a lot of tax cuts were announced only in September 2019, so government actually did not have too much leeway in budget 2020, but still they have tried to do something whereby they have reduced the slab rates or reshuffled the slab rates for the individual taxpayers, whereby if individual taxpayers give up on the deductions which they are claiming in India, they can go by the new personal tax rate regime, which is more beneficial and liberal than the earlier one. But if you effectively calculate, what happens is that only if you are an individual who is claiming deduction of less than 250,000 INR, then only the new regime becomes favorable for the Indian individual. But from an expat point of view, who do not want to make huge investment or do not want to make any savings in India, which was earlier allowed as a deduction, this new regime could be of good use, because now they would not be in a way forced to make investments into long-term instruments in India to claim tax benefits, because now if they go for the new regime, the tax rates are better, and at the same time they are not required to make any new investments. There were certain changes made on the residency law. So earlier, any Indian citizen who goes outside of India and comes back to India, he was allowed to stay in India for 182 days before he becomes a resident in India. Now that limit has been reduced to 120 days. Further, also there are certain conditions earlier provided as to when a resident would qualify as an ordinary resident in India and liable to pay tax on global income. In those cases, earlier condition was that he has to be present in India for 730 days in last 7 years, and he should be a resident in 2 out of 10 years. So what was happening actually for US expats coming to India, that in the 3rd year they used to become ordinary resident and their global income was becoming taxable in India. However, with the revision in the rule, now they have said that individual has to be a non-resident in 7 out of 10 preceding years, which means that he has to be a resident in 4 out of the 10 years. So now a US national coming to India for deportation would not become an ordinary resident of India till 4 years. Earlier, he used to become resident in the 3rd year itself. Now he will not become a resident till the 4th year. So he will not be exposed, or his global income will not be exposed to tax in India till 4 years, and it will be taxable only after the 4th year. In line with global practices, India also tried to introduce stateless concept of stateless person, whereby which is mainly applicable to Indian citizens, whereby the government has said that if an Indian citizen is not paying tax in any other country, because either he is shifting his base regularly to avoid becoming a resident in any other country, then he would be liable to tax in India as he is a citizen of India. So here there was slight confusion as to whether people who are going outside of India to countries like UAE or other countries where there is actually no individual tax, whether those guys also would be covered in this law or not. So the government has clarified that they will not be covered, and only this is to tax people who are trying to avoid residency in any of the country. From a foreign company perspective, there were certain amendments which were made and very important. So India, on the lines of BEPS project, had introduced thin capitalization, something similar to thin capitalization rules, that is the limitation on interest deduction. So if any Indian company is availing loan from its foreign company, then the interest is only allowed up to 30% of the EBITDA which it makes, and certain exceptions from these provisions were provided to banking companies. However, foreign branch of a banking company was missing. So for example, if a Bank of America has an Indian branch, and if you take a loan from that branch, that exemption was missing in the provisions which were introduced in earlier years. So to rectify that, the provisions have been brought in that even if you take a loan from a foreign bank which is operating in India through a branch, then this provisions would not apply. India had actually introduced significant economic presence rule, which was mainly to tax the digital transactions. But given that OECD and BEPS are finalizing the final report on taxation of digital transaction, SCP was deferred by 1 year. And in place of that, certain source rule taxation has been provided under the Indian local law itself. So if any advertisement revenue is generated outside of India, which is to target Indian customers, now that would be considered as income which has a source in India and may become taxable in India. Obviously, this is an amendment in the local laws of India. So if the tax treaty benefits are available, then this cannot be invoked by the Indian tax authority. So while it has come under the Indian tax laws, but it may be redundant because India-US has a tax treaty, and the taxpayers from US who are carrying out either the advertisement activity which is targeting Indian customer or collection of data from India for sale of goods or services can still claim that this income is still not taxable under the tax treaty, and the Indian local laws does not apply to us. Then there was an exemption provided under local laws from royalty income earned from cinematographic films, though that exemption has been removed now. So now any royalty income is taxable, including royalty from cinematographic films. Further, for a lot of global funds, there were fund managers who were based out of India, and there was an issue as to whether that fund manager who is sitting into India can constitute a permanent establishment for that global fund in India or not. So a couple of years back, the government had come out with regulations stating that if a global fund has a Indian fund manager, that fund manager would not be considered as a permanent establishment of the global fund, subject to satisfying of certain conditions. So there were certain conditions which were actually not helping the industry at large. So there were a lot of recommendations from the fund industry, where out of which a couple of suggestions have been accepted by the government. So one of the recommendation was that one of the conditions to not constitute a PE was that the global fund should not have more than 5% Indian investment in that fund. So what was happening, that the fund manager, to show that he also has the skin in the game, used to invest in the fund, and he used to take up 2-3% of the limit which was allowed for the Indian investment. So it was prayed, or it was requested, that that fund manager has to invest in the fund to show people that he is also having the skin in the game and he is also having investments. So that investment should not be counted for the purpose of the 5% limit. So now that has been rightly removed for investment made by the fund manager up to INR 250 million during the first 3 years. Second was a setup period, that the fund was required to maintain a corpus of INR 100,000 million within 6 months from the end of the year in which it is set up. Now that has been extended to 12 years from the date of the setup of the fund. Further, a couple of important changes for non-resident taxpayers was, in light of the BEPS project, government has now provided in the local laws itself that it would have power to amend tax treaties to bring out the principle that the tax treaty is not only for double taxation, to avoid double taxation, but also it should ensure that tax treaties are not structured in such a manner that it results in reduced taxation or non-taxation for the foreign companies in India. Further, one of the biggest move, I would say, for from a foreign company perspective, is exemption provided to foreign companies or non-residents from filing Indian income tax return. So earlier, only foreign companies which were earning dividend income or income from certain specified interest income were not required to file tax return in India. Now the scope has been expanded to say that if any foreign company or a non-resident earns any interest income, dividend income, fees for technical services income, that is any service income, or like management fee, like any service income or any royalty income, then he would not be required to file an Indian tax return. But only twist which the government has brought about is that the taxes should have been deducted as per the Indian local laws. So from a US perspective, this becomes a win-win situation, because India-US tax treaty has a higher rate of 15% on royalties and fees for technical services, whereas Indian local laws provides for a tax rate of only 10.92%. So any US company which is doing business with India and paying 10.92% tax in India can now onwards not pay, not file any tax return in India. So that's a welcome move. However, still there are certain situations where the tax return filing requirement remains. So for example, foreign company availing tax treaty benefits. So in US context, if any company is taking advantage of the make available clause provided under the tax treaty and claiming that its income is not taxable in India, then it would be required to report or file a tax return in India, so that government of India can examine and verify the claim made by the foreign company. Where taxes deducted as per the tax treaty not relevant for US companies, because treaty rate is higher. However, for countries other than US, like China, Germany or any other European companies, the tax rate is 10%, whereas Indian law provides 11%. So if someone is offering tax at 10% as against 11% provided under Indian local laws, he would still be required to file a tax return in India. Where no Indian registration number is obtained by the US company and taxes are deducted at a higher rate of 20%, then technically an obligation still remains for the foreign company to file a tax return in India. If the foreign company has obtained an advance ruling from India wherever it has been ruled that taxes are not liable to be paid by the foreign company or the US company in India, then also it would have to file a tax return in India so that tax authorities in India can verify that the fact which were represented by the company during the course of the advance ruling which it has obtained are still valid or not. Or if you are earning any income which is in the nature of IPS, that is independent, which is claimed exempt under the IPS or the DPS clause of the tax treaty, you would be still be required to file a tax return in India. So this is one of the very important amendment. So all companies which are doing business with India would have to look at their situation and decide whether they would like to opt for this new exemption which has been provided by the Indian government. Further, another big change was removal of dividend distribution tax. So earlier what was happening in India, the Indian company which was declaring dividends was required to pay a dividend distribution tax which was amounting to 20.56%. And what was happening, majority of the company which were earning dividend income were not getting tax credit in the home country because this dividend distribution tax was not paid by the foreign company as a tax, but it was paid by the Indian company as a dividend distribution tax. Further, Indian residents were also required to pay tax on the dividend income from last year. So it was resulting in three-tier tax on the same income. And in order to avoid that anomaly, government has now removed the dividend distribution tax. Because of removal of dividend distribution tax, now the taxability would be in the hands of the recipient, that is a shareholder. In case of a resident shareholder, that is an Indian resident shareholder, it would be liable to tax as per the corporate tax rate or the slab rates applicable to each of the individual. Whereas in respect of a foreign company, the tax rate would be 20% plus applicable surcharge and education cess as provided under the Indian local laws or the tax rate provided under the India-US tax treaty. So if you look at from an India-US perspective, tax rate provided for companies which are holding more than 50% in the Indian, 15% in the Indian, sorry, more than 10% in the Indian company is only 15%. So earlier the Indian company while declaring dividend, was paying a dividend distribution tax of 20.56%. Now that tax rate can straight away get reduced to 15% because of the India-US tax treaty. So as I mentioned earlier, so the moment US shareholder invokes this treaty provisions and claims this 15% beneficial tax rate, it would be required to file a tax return in India because the taxes are not deducted as per the local laws of India. If it does not want to file the tax return or where it does not have the 10% shareholding in the Indian company, then any which way the Indian tax rate of 21.84% is beneficial. So he will go by 21.84% and no tax return filing requirement is there. And also if you go under the tax treaty, then the beneficial ownership is one of the conditions provided under the tax treaty, which also will have to be satisfied by the US company. So just to give a illustrative example, so if $100 or 100 INR was earned by a US company, the Indian company where US company has an investment, earlier the distributable surplus was only 79.44 available with the Indian company, which was going to the US shareholder. But now that 79.44 can go up to 85. So it's a good change for the non-resident companies, especially for companies, countries like Hong Kong, where the tax rate is low as 5%, or Mauritius. But for US also, 15% is better than what was earlier of 20.56%. Certain changes have been made to the withholding tax regime. So FPIs were allowed a beneficial tax rate of 5% on investment in certain specified security. Those limits were expiring on July 2020. Now those limits have been extended to July 2023. Certain local withholding tax changes have been made whereby the rates have been reduced on payment of technical service fee and for cooperative societies. One of the another important change is that in order to track as to who all are selling goods over an e-commerce platform and whether they are appropriately reporting their income or not. So mainly as per the records available, approximately only 6% of the taxpayers are there in India out of such a huge population. So the in every budget, government's aim is to increase the overall tax base in India. So to increase that tax base, withholding tax provisions are introduced more and more in India. So one more withholding tax provision introduced is that e-commerce players who are while making payments to their vendors would be required to withhold tax from the payments of the vendors, and those vendors would be liable to get a refund of these taxes by filing their tax return in India if they do not have any taxable income, or get a setup of this withholding taxes if they have income tax payable in India. This is mainly to see that a lot of players have started selling online in India, and online culture is now increasing in India. So to track people who are selling but not reporting their income, these provisions have been introduced. And also currently there is no clarity, but prima facie it appears based on the regulation that this will even apply when say a e-commerce player is making payment to somebody outside India who is listed on its website and selling services or goods through the e-commerce platform. Further, withholding, similar to withholding tax, the tax collection at source provisions have also been introduced. These are mainly applicable to resident making investment outside of India or resident Indians going outside India on foreign travel, where the traveler and the banker is required to withhold taxes on that payment, which again would be available as a tax credit. One more is that if any Indian company is selling goods to any other party, from the selling of goods it is required to withhold taxes. So for example, if an Indian company is selling goods to a US company, sorry, the example mentioned is other way around. So if an Indian company is selling goods to US company, which basically means that it is a purchase for an US company, still it would be liable to withhold some tax from those purchases so that to ensure that the purchaser is reporting appropriately. So a lot of apprehensions have been raised that for foreign companies this would become very cumbersome to compile when they are only purchasing from India. We are expecting that government should notify an exemption for purchases made by the foreign company, and this should apply only for the local companies. Moving on, one of the important changes was that India is moving from a paper style of tax assessment, tax audits, to a more online phase, whereby the first level revenue audits have already been done in a online manner through faceless proceedings. So they want to extend this to the second level of appellate proceedings as well. Government also wants to introduce taxpayer charter, which will basically lay down the rights of all the Indian taxpayers. So if tax authorities are not responding on time or are not providing appropriate resolution, the taxpayer charter will allow Indian taxpayers or foreign taxpayers to have a legal recourse against the tax authorities, which is a very welcome move. And as everyone would have an idea, India is typically a country where litigation lasts for a long period of time. So currently India has around more than 400,000 pending appeals, 9.32 trillion INR amount locked in as demand, and direct tax collection for 18-19 was again 11.37 trillion. So in order to give resolution to disputes which are pending with various courts, government has introduced a dispute resolution scheme known as Vivad Se Vishwas scheme, which would translate into dispute to trust scheme, which will help in reducing this litigation significantly. It's kind of an amnesty scheme whereby you can just pay the tax which is due in India and close all the appeal matters, the penalty and the interest amount which is leviable on the tax demand would be waived off by the government. This mainly is done to unlock a lot of pendency of the appeals, and also a lot of tax revenue also would be received through this entire process by the government. So a lot of frivolous appeal will go away, a lot of cases people would look to settle the disputes. So this scheme is applicable in two phases. If the tax demand is paid up to 31st January 2020, then you pay only 100% of the tax due, and no penalty or interest is payable. If you pay after 31st March but before 30th June, then you pay 110% of the tax and penalty and interest is waived off. Further, if your tax matter is resolved and you are fighting a case for interest or penalty, then if you pay before 31st March, you pay only 25%. And if you pay after 31st March but before 30th June, then you pay only 30%. So this is one of the important scheme which government hopes to clear the entire litigation. Some of the other important measures were providing incentive to the startups, whereby the ESOPs rules have been liberalized, whereby the taxation would trigger only after the inflow or the cash flow is realized by the person receiving the ESOP. Tax break is provided now for 3 years, but it can be claimed in any 10 years. Earlier this was only for 7 years. Certain compliance audit, that is the tax audit limits, have been enhanced from 1 million INR to 5 million INR. So companies which are having a turnover in India of 5 million INR would now be subjected to tax audit. Earlier it was 1 million, but these limits are applicable only if the transactions are non-cash transaction. Due date of filing tax return and transfer pricing have been shuffled so that before filing tax return, transfer pricing and tax audit has to be done so that tax returns are pre-filled. With this, I come to an end to the direct tax proposal. Now, my colleague Shivendra would take you through the indirect tax proposals. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Nishit, and good morning to everyone joining from the US. I will be taking you through the indirect tax changes that were introduced in the budget 2020. These comprise changes in the GST legislation and also the Customs Act related changes. So first we'll look at the GST changes. The first one being, the background to this change is that the government has been looking to tighten the loopholes since the introduction of GST from 1st July 2017, and in this course they have expanded the scope of persons defaulting under the provision and they have included additional persons who can be charged with committing of an offense. That is, if there is an incorrect invoice or a supply without an invoice or taking of credit incorrectly on the basis of an invoice. Earlier, only the supplier was liable and charged with the committing of that offense. Now, even the beneficiary of such a transaction, that is a person availing tax credit on such a supply, that is the recipient, can also be held as an offender. The two conditions which need to be satisfied are that the person should also retain the benefit of that transaction and that transaction should be committed on the instance of such a person. Obviously, the penal provisions also, which are applicable to the supplier in this case, would be applicable to the recipient also. Similar change in another stringent section, which also invites prosecution, has been brought in. The first change in this section is that a lacuna which was existing earlier, that taking of input tax credit without issuance of invoice was not an offense earlier. Now this has also been made as an offense. The background to this is that many of the cases government has unearthed recently where input tax credit has been availed fraudulently without backup invoices being in place. this has got to be corrected. Secondly, the same change which was earlier discussed, that is the person committing the offense has the ambit of that has been widened and the person who is the recipient of that supply has been included as an offender. And the crux of this amendment is that it has become very critical to avail ITC based on correct invoice and at the correct place of business, so that bona fide recipients are not troubled and can avoid increased litigation. So input tax credit should be taken very carefully so that offense under this section can be avoided. Moving ahead, on the GST front, there were certain major announcements by the finance minister, some of which being the first one being the system of cash reward sought to be introduced by the government to incentivize customers to seek an invoice. Many a times it has been observed that the end part of the supply chain, that is from the retail to the ultimate consumer, invoices are not generally issued and taxes are evaded at such a point. Hence, a cash reward incentive when given to the customers would force the suppliers to give the invoices, and the practice of avoiding taxes can be curbed. Second important announcement is that the government has said that they will introduce a incentive scheme for the exporters. This will be a new incentive scheme which will be based on refunding of taxes and duties which are embedded in the supply chain and for which no refund is presently available to an exporter. The background of this change is that the current scheme of export incentives for the exporters is likely to expire given the adverse ruling in the World Trade Organization against India, and hence the current scheme, which is the merchandise export from India scheme, is not going to be operational, is not likely to be operational from 1st April 2020, and hence it will be replaced by this new scheme called the RODTP scheme. Third important announcement is that the e-invoicing, that is a provision recently introduced by the government that all the invoices of companies above a particular threshold, that is above one, having of companies having turnover above 1 billion rupees, would be compulsorily required to issue e-invoices when a B2B supply occurs. So that is the details of the invoice would be required to be uploaded by the supplier on the government system and obtain a computer generated number which has to be imprinted on the invoice. This is also a provision which is seeking to cover the leakages in the GST system. Fourth announcement is that the simplified return scheme, which was already announced by the government, they have re-emphasized that this will be implemented from April 2020. Coming to the customs law changes, I will begin with the most important change here. This is which relates to the free trade agreements. So India has signed a lot of free trade agreements with various countries, some of them which are being countries of the of ASEAN, that is Association of Southeast Asian Nations, and Sri Lanka, South Korea, some of these countries. Usually on import from these countries, customs duty concessions are granted without much questioning, and the certificate of origin which is produced by the importer and which is issued by the prescribed authority in the exporter's country is usually accepted as proof of origin of goods. However, there had been recent cases where government was taking active action on suspending the preferential duty and not relying on the certificate of origin and opening various investigations. However, these the measures taken by the government were struck down by the courts due to lack of provisions in the domestic law. So government has sought to give itself powers now to question this certificate of origin and complete a time-bound verification for this for these imports. And this verification can be done by the officer within a period of 5 years from the date of the claim of the preferential duty. powers have also been granted to suspend preferential duty based on import of goods. Benefit can be suspended based on the information available with the department, and also goods can be confiscated. Due to introduction of these powers and these amendments, it is likely that government will question the imports more and more, and we can see cases of suspension of benefits on imports from countries with whom India has a preferential tariff agreement. Hence, it is very important for the importer availing these benefits to prepare in advance and produce the documents and evidences that may be required by the officer to prove that the claim of a concession is genuine and the origin of goods is indeed from the country with which India has a preferential tariff agreement. This will safeguard the possibility of from denial of concessions under the agreement. Moving ahead, government has introduced various safeguard measures for the domestic industry due to the increasing trade deficit. These measures have been introduced. The first one being the power to prohibit the import of goods. Earlier, the power to prohibit import of goods on the ground of injury to the economy of the country was only restricted to a few goods, that is gold and silver. This power has now been expanded to include any goods. So the government can now in effect prohibit the import or export of any goods if on the ground of injury to the economy of the country. Second change in this regard is that the power to impose safeguard duty earlier existed when the government thought that it would lead to adverse impact on the domestic industry. So earlier this power was limited to only imposing a safeguard duty. Now these powers have been expanded and various safeguard measures can also be imposed by the government, including imposition of tariff quotas. The third important change is that imposition of health cess. This cess is similar to a customs duty, which is a basic customs duty that is levied on imported goods. The rate of this duty has been kept at 5% on the value of the goods as of now, and this is only applicable to the import of medical devices falling under chapter heading 9018 to 9022 of the HSN classification. Lastly, government has, while introducing the budget, has laid bare its intention that their intention is to cut down on the exemptions of customs duty that are available to the assessees right now. They have government has reviewed this list and has either removed the exemptions or increased the duty rates on various commodities. A few of the sectors which are worth mentioning in this regard are the chocolate and other food preparations, patent leather, electrically operated vehicles, solar cells, footwear, and furniture. Either the duty has exemption has been removed or duty existing rate has been amended and increased anywhere between the range of 10% to 30%. These amendments have been brought in to boost the Make in India initiative of the government, and the government has also announced that further review of customs duty exemptions would be undertaken, and more goods are likely to be exemptions are likely to be withdrawn in September 2020. With this, we have also come to the end of the indirect tax related changes.
Thank you very much for the presentation, Nishit and Shivendra. We hope the listeners found the insights shared by our speakers to be interesting and useful. We are now open to questions. I would request all the participants to put their questions on the bottom right in the chat box on your computer screen, and we can take them one by one. Thank you.
All right, it seems that we do not have any questions at this point in time from the audience. Okay, we have one question. This is from Ali. The question is, if an individual invests in Indian stock market with a demat account, what will be the impact of taxes in the new budget? Nishit, any initial remarks for Ali?
Yes, so the answer to this is that from a tax perspective, nothing has changed except for the dividend distribution tax removal and taxation of dividends in the hands of the shareholder. So if it's an individual shareholder who is investing, then the tax rate would be as per the slab rates applicable to the individuals. And if he's a US citizen or US resident, then he can claim the tax treaty benefit and the tax rate can go down to 21% or 25%, the treaty rate. But if it's an Indian resident, the tax rate can be as high as 43% on the dividend if the income is higher than INR 50 million. Also, from a tax rate perspective, there are no specific changes on the capital gains tax rate in India in this budget. But just for your information, the tax rates are for long-term capital gains, the tax rate is 10%. And for short-term capital gains tax, the tax rate is 15%. And this is, I'm talking about investment in listed equity shares.
Thank you very much for your remarks, Nishit. Ali, I hope that answers your question. I don't think we have any other questions for now. Neil, would you want to just give the closing remarks?
Yes, I just wanted to thank everybody who joined us this morning. And if you have any other questions or if you would like to reach out to the Nexdigm team, I think they have their contact information listed on the current slide, but you can also send us an email at the chamber and we would be happy to connect you with the SKP and Nexdigm team. Additionally, I'm not sure this was mentioned earlier, but all of these PowerPoints and handouts are available in your toolbar for this webinar. There are two PDFs, the SKP Nexdigm Tax Services PDF, and also the Nexdigm SKP Union Budget, which is this presentation. So if you would like a printed copy of these handouts, you can find them attached to this webinar toolbar. And Jugal, if we could keep the toolbar open for just a couple of minutes so that people can download those if they want them, I think that would be very helpful. But with that, I just want to thank you all for joining us, and we hope to have you again next time, and we hope you found this valuable. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Neil. We will keep the webinar on for a couple of minutes for everyone to download the files that you just mentioned. Thanks for bringing that up. And we'll also share a recording of the presentation with you for you to share with your members later. Thank you very much once again for the opportunity, and we look forward to doing this again in the future with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Goodbye. Have a good day.